بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن الحمد لله تعالى نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كلام الله وخير الهدى هدى محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Continuing with the Tafseer of Surah Al-Hujurat. In our last lesson, we reached the saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, إِن جَاءَكُمْ فَاسِقٌ بِنَبَئٍ فَتَبَيَّنُوا. That if a fasiq, and we defined what a fasiq is the one that has gone astray in terms of religious affair or socially or culturally accepted norms. That إِن جَاءَكُمْ فَاسِقٌ بِنَبَئٍ فَتَبَيَّنُوا. That if a fasiq, it brings news or information to you, the automatic default should be to what? To believe or to disbelieve? No, we do not believe his news, nor do we disbelieve it. But what do? We verify the authenticity of his news. And this ayah, as we studied in the last lesson, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made the wisdom of that known to us. And the wisdom of that is, and to see قَوْمًا بِجَهَالًا, lest you may harm a people in ignorance. فَتُصْبِحُ عَلَى مَا فَعَلْتُمْ نَادِمِينَ. And then afterwards, you'll be full of regrets. So we covered this ayah in our last lesson. The verse we're going to be looking at today, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala, is a very important verse in terms of where we are geographically and also the time in which we're living in today. And it applies to all time, but more specifically, the time we're in today. And the verse we're looking at today, inshallah ta'ala, from Surah Al-Hujurat, is the saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala orders were ordered in the Qur'an. And the order of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is, وَإِن طَائِفَتَانِ مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ اقْتَتَلُوا فَأَصْلِحُوا بَيْنَهُمَا. So the verse we're looking at today, inshallah ta'ala, is the saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَإِن طَائِفَتَانِ, if two groups or two factions of the believers اقْتَتَلُوا, they fight each other, meaning they go to war with each other, to a point they're even killing each other, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us certain orders. So first and foremost, let it be known that it is possible for two groups of believers to fight and to kill one another. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in this ayah, that وَإِن طَائِفَتَانِ, if two groups of believers, اقتتلوا, they kill and they fight each other. So it's a possibility. Because although the believers are the best of the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this could still happen. And the best of the believers, after the prophets and messengers of who? The Sahaba, the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But yet, they had disagreements amongst each other to a point that sometimes it led to war between the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, radiallahu anhum. But the causes of war amongst us is not the same as the Sahaba, radiallahu anhum. Nowadays, the major causes of war between the believers are the following. Either border disputes, you know, borders, these border disputes could lead believers in our time, not like the time of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum or in time of the Salaf, because in those days, as long as you are a Muslim, the same way you have a passport nowadays, whether it's a British passport, a Danish passport, a French passport, because of the EU, you enter all these countries because European passport. In those days, your Hawiyah, your identity, your passport, your gateway to all these places were what? Your Islam, khalas. So nowadays, border wars. Another cause of fighting between the believers, unfortunately, is tribalism. That in some parts of the world today, you have Muslims that have been at civil war. They speak the same language, some of them. They look exactly the same. And most importantly, they share one faith, al-Islam, and they killed each other for decades because of tribalism. Another reason we have in our time nowadays, where people fight, believers, each other, is nationalism. And all of these things are the cause of what? Or propagations of what? Of Jahiliyyah. No matter how much a person has knowledge, has memorized the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, anybody that fights purely along these lines, this is what? Jahiliyyah. This is ignorance. Which is why when the companion came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he complained about another companion, and this was Bilal radiallahu anhu, when the other companion said to him, and remember this is a sahabi, this is a companion of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said to Bilal radiallahu anhu, Ya ibn al-ajamiyyah, son of a non-Arab woman. That's all he said. Compared to the statements people make nowadays, the derogatory racist statements people make nowadays, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and this is one of the best of the companions of Prophet sallam, that made this statement, he said to him, innaka mru'un fi kal jahiliyyah. Verily you have jahiliyyah, ignorance in you. So it's ignorance. All this is a call of ignorance. And most importantly, no matter what the reasons may be, this goes back to the plans and the plots of Shaytan. Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said about the Shaytan in hadith, that قَدْ أَيْسَ الشَّيْطَانِ أَنْ يَعْبُدَهُ مُصَلُّونَ فِي جَزِيرَةِ الْعَرَبِ وَلَكِنْ تَحْرِيشْ بَيْنَهُمْ. That when the Shaytan, he saw the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and that which are upon from ibadah and tawheed, he gave up all hopes, because he doesn't know the future, what happened later on. He gave up all hopes that those who pray, I mean pray properly, they'll ever worship the Shaytan. And the worship of Shaytan is to obey him. He gave up all hopes. But one thing the Shaytan, he never gave up hope on, tahrish baynahum, to cause them to fight one another. So all this is from the what? The plots of Shaytan. So wa in ta'ifatan minal mu'minina qtatalu. If two groups of the believers, they fight, what is the order from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for us? Do we support one side against the other? Or do we just adopt a silent, neutral stance? What do? We don't support one against the other, nor do we adopt a neutral stance, but rather Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he commanded us. And a command from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a what? An obligation. You have no choice in the matter that maybe I may do something about it. No. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, فَأَصْلِحُوا بَيْنَهُمَا. Order, command. You must bring settlement, reconcile between these two groups of believers. Order from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That whenever you see two groups of believers fighting each other, it's an order and a command from Allah azza wa jal that you have to, at your utmost effort, even if it's going to cost you financially, to bring sulh, settlement between them. And what is a sulh, since Allah ta'ala has ordered us with this? What is sulh? We covered this in our last lesson, what sulh is. That sulh is not the same as hukum. For example, this brother here owes this brother 100 riyal. The ruling is for him to give him 100, finish. But with sulh, with settlement, it could be different. For the sake of peace, for the sake of reconciling, in sulh, you compromise. So I say, brother, look, I know it holds you 100 riyal, but please, the brother's having a hard time, take 50. Take 50. This is a sulh, settlement. So with settlement, one of the two parties, or in some cases, both parties will compromise and they'll forego their rights. So it's upon the believers, when you see this argument or fighting amongst the believers, to do a sulh, to do a settlement between the believers in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to seek reconciliation between them. And that's why, because sulh, it may cost them money, it could be financially burdening. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he mentions sulh in the Quran, he said, وَسُلْحُ khayr. And reconciling and settlement is good. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions after that, وَأُحْدِرَتِ الْأَنفُسَ الشُّحُ. That although it's good, the soul naturally inclines towards stinginess, to be miserly. Because automatically, the moment you go into a settlement, you're going to have to do what? Compromise financially. So even if it's going to cost us financially, it's an obligation upon us. After this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, after you reconcile, you've settled between them, فَإِنْ بَغَتْ إِحْدَاهُمَا عَلَى الْأُخْرَى. If one of them transgresses against the other, this is the point now you take sides. فَقَاتِلُوا الَّتِي تَبْغِي حَتَّى تَفِيَ إِلَىٰ أَمْرِ اللَّهِ. Fight the one that is transgressed after the settlement until he returns to what? إِلَىٰ أَمْرِ اللَّهِ. To the affair of Allah. أي شَرْعُهُ وَدِينُهُ. Until he's come back to the sharia, the ordinance of Allah, and the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's when you take sides. However, فَإِنْ فَاءَتْ. After you've taken side, if he comes back, what do? Do you continue to fight him? لا. if he comes back to the order of Allah, فَأَصْلِحُ بَيْنَهُمَا بِالْعَدْلِ. The moment he comes back, you stop fighting him. In the same way that when you're fighting the believers, or believer that's gone against the order of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there's rules and regulations. One of those rules is, if he turns his back in the battle, you're not allowed to kill him. If you capture his wife or his children in the battle, you cannot take them as right and possess, you can't take it as booty, because they're still what? Believers in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَإِنْ فَاءَتْ. And if he comes back, فَأَصْلِحُ بَيْنَهُمَا بِالْعَدْلِ. Reconcile or settle between them. So now in these ayat, Allah has ordered us twice to do what? Sulh. The first sulh is to stop the what? The fighting, the bloodshed. The second sulh is not the same as the first. In this second instance, when you do sulh, is to assess the damages that have been caused by both parties. And for each party, bil adl, now with full justice to compensate the other. So for example, two groups fight each other. This person cost 100, or he damaged 100,000 worth of goods. Or his damage was 100,000. This other person, he caused damages of 1,000,000. So when Allah Ta'ala says, أَصْلِحُ بَيْنَهُمَ بِالْعَدْلِ وَأَقْسِتُ, and act in justice. How do we solve this now? The one that has caused 1,000,000 riyal worth of damage, what does he have to do? How much does he pay? He pays 200,000. In this second sulh now, reconciliation between the both of them, he has to be bil-adl. وَأَقْسِتُ. And then Allah Ta'ala ends by saying, and act in a justified manner. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ الْمُقْسِتِينَ. That verily Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he loves those who are just. So it's good to be just, because Allah ta'ala will love you. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, al-muqsitun ala manabir min nur. Those who are just, yawm qiyamah, will be upon pulpits of light on the day of judgment. And they'll be upon the right side of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, inna Allah yuhibbu al-muqsitin. And then in the next ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes it known to us, why is it we should do sulh amongst the believers? What's the next ayah? إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ إِخْوَةً. The believers are brothers. The same way, if you have a problem with your brother, with your auntie, somebody in your family, is the natural thing to do is to do what? To reconcile and settle. But the brotherhood we have, the brotherhood of deen, is stronger than that. إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ إِخْوَةً فَأَصْلِحُ بَيْنَ أَخْوَيْكُمْ. That verily, the brothers are, or the Muslims, or the believers are brothers. So do sulh between your brothers. Now somebody may ask, is it possible for a Muslim or group of Muslims to fight other Muslims and still be Muslims? Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in hadith, sibab al muslim fusuq, to insult another Muslim is fisq, it's a major sin. Wa qatluhu kufr, and to kill a Muslim is kufr, it's an act of disbelief. So can a Muslim or a group of Muslims attack another group of Muslims and fight them and still remain Muslims and still remain believers? Is it possible? So this is kufr duna kufr, kufr of a lesser degree. And what's the proof of this? Anything the Prophet ﷺ said is kufr, it takes you outside the fold of Islam. That's the default, unless there comes an evidence to make it of a lesser degree. And what's the evidence is of a lesser degree? What's the proof that it's of a lesser degree, that this kufr, this fighting the believers is going to take you outside the fold of Islam? Barakallahu fiqh. The ayah which you're studying now, if two groups of the believers, they fight. So although they're fighting each other, Allah Ta'ala still calls them what? Believers. Jazakallah khairan. Although they're still fighting each other, Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala still calls them what? Believers. So there's certain things that the Prophet ﷺ refers to as kufr, but it doesn't mean, like he said, this level. It takes outside the fold of Islam. Like the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ithnan bihima al-kufr. There's two categories of people, or two practices that people do, that bihima, that due to these practices, they have with them huma bihimul kufr. They have with them kufr, disbelief. He said the first of it was al-ta'nu fi nasab wa niyaha ala al-mayyit, to doubt the validity of somebody's lineage, or to wail and cry excessively over the dead person. The Prophet said this practice is kufr. So does it mean that everybody who wails and cries over a dead person is a kafir? La. Or doubt the validity. It's a major sin, but it doesn't take you outside the fold of what? The fold of al-Islam. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ends the ayah by saying, wattaqullah. And fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Fear Allah by doing what? By doing that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has ordered you to do, which is to cause or bring about settlements between your brothers. And taqwallah. When you say to someone, ittaqillah, what does it mean then? You have to do what Allah has ordered you to do by staying away from his prohibitions and fulfilling the orders of Allah. And the order of Allah has to do what? Sulh, la'allakum turhamun. In order that you may receive mercy. In the next ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu. Allah ta'ala calls us in the name of Iman. La yaskhar qawm min qawm. And this ayah is serious. Because something that happens a lot in all periods of time, and especially the time we're in nowadays, because a lot of the violations that people engage in nowadays, they justify in the name of, I'm only joking. It's just a joke. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu. La yaskhar qawm min qawm. Oh, you believe. Let not a set of people mock another set of people. Asa an yakunu khayran minhum. Maybe they're better than them, those men. Wala nisa min nisa. And no women or set of women should mock another set of women. Asa an yakunna khayran minhun. Maybe the women they're mocking are better than them. And the ulama, they say maybe better than them men here means indallah, in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Like the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Rubba ash'at aghbar. مدفوع بالأبواب لو أقسم بالله لأبرا. There are some people you see, they look dusty, their hair is dusty, their clothes are dirty, they look disheveled. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, such a person is rejected at every door. Nobody wants to employ him, nobody wants to marry to their daughters. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, such a person that you look down upon, لو أقسم على الله, if he was to swear by Allah that such and such would take place, due to his position with Allah, that thing will take place. But yet we look down upon them. So maybe in the sight of Allah, is better the one you're mocking. The ulama also say, maybe it is better than you in the future. You don't know what tomorrow holds. The one you're mocking today may be better than you tomorrow. And even in some cases, maybe it's even better than you currently. But yet you mock them. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, لا يسخر قوم من قوم. Allah Ta'ala said, لا يسخر قوم من قوم. Not let a people mock another people. ولا تلمزوا أنفسكم. And this is a strange ayah. Allah Ta'ala says, do not insult yourselves. Is it possible for a person to insult himself? And you find this many ayahs in the Quran where Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala will say, for example, ولا تأكل أموالكم. Don't eat up your own wealth in falsehood. ولا تقتلوا أنفسكم. Don't kill your own self. The reason Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala refers to this as your own self is because the believer, a true believer, the honor of his brother is like his own honor. The wealth of his brother is like his own wealth. So Allah ta'ala tells you, don't eat your own wealth, because your brother's wealth is your wealth. Your brother's honor is your honor. And that's why when it came to the hadithatul ifk, the lie that was made against Aisha radiallahu anha, what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say? لو ظن المؤمنون والمؤمنين بأنفسهم خيرا. If only the believing men and the believing women thought well of who? Of Aisha? بأنفسهم, of their own selves in a good way. Because the honor Aisha is their honor. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَلَا تَلْمِزُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ. Do not insult each other. And the ulama also say, وَلَا تَلْمِزُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ. The reason Allah ta'ala said, do not insult yourself, is because of this. That كلنا بمنزلة الإنسان. All of us, the one you're insulting, and yourselves, you are what? All human beings. So when you insult a human being, due to a physical trait in him, due to a physical trait in that person, you're only insulting who? Your own self. He's human like you. So whether he's black, whether he's white, whether he's brown, whether he's red, whether he's tall, whether he's short, at the end of the day, he's a what? Human being like you. So when you do such a thing, you're only insulting who? You're only insulting your own self. And they say likewise, وَلَا تَلْمِزُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ. Do not insult yourself. The moment you insult somebody, you've insulted yourself. As the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لَعَنَ اللَّهُ مَنْ سَبَّ وَالِدَيْهِ. May Allah curse the one that insults his own parent. The Sahaba, they asked the Prophet sallam, is it possible for a person to insult his own parents? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, يَسُبُّ أَبَا رَجُلٍ فَيَسُبُّ أَبَا وَيَسُبُّ أُمَّهُ فَيَسُبُّ أُمَّهُ. That a person insults another person's father. And what does a person do in return? Insults his own father. And insults somebody's mother. And what does a person do in return? Insults his mother. The moment you throw insults at people, they're going to throw insults back at you. And most importantly, pointing out somebody's physical defect or character defect, when you look at somebody and you see a defect, or what you may interpret as a defect, that is too white, or is too tall, is too pale, he's got freckles, he's got red hair, blonde hair, whatever it is. When you're criticizing this person, what are you really criticizing? Did he choose to be black? Did he choose to be white? Did he choose to be tall? Did he choose to be short? What are you insulting? Whose defect are you pointing out? The defect of who? A'udhu billah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Dangerous. That's who you're accusing. And even if a person has a disability or particular defect, who are you blaming for this now, for this defect you're pointing out? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For example, when you find a wall that's not properly erected and leaning over, do you go to that wall, you stupid wall? How could you be built like this? Or do you blame the architect? The architect, or the one that built the wall. So likewise, when you look at somebody's physical characteristics, you say, this and that, who are you pointing finger of blame at? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also, pointing out a person's non-physical characteristics, for example, a trait, a character trait. Maybe the person's a bit slow, he doesn't understand things very quickly, or he's very talkative. This is not also a good thing to do. If a person has shortcomings in terms of the characters, your duty is to do what? To advise them. If you find you can advise them directly, you could write a letter to them, you could even be mysterious about it, but it's not to mock them. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "La tudhhir shamatata li'akhik." Do not show or rejoice in the shortcoming of a brother, of your brother. فَيُعَافِيَهُ اللَّهُ وَيَبْتَلِيكُ. That Allah Ta'ala may remove that thing from him and test you with it. So do not show or do not show happiness in the shortcoming of your brother. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَا تَنَابَذُوا بِالْأَلْقَابِ. Do not call each other by nicknames. Another thing which is prohibited. And in some cultures, some traditions, it's okay to call each other by nicknames, even if they're insulted nicknames. So many a times I've told this story, that when I lived in East Africa, there was a brother who lived on the same compound as us. All this time, I thought this was just his name. The same way my name now, if I was to tell you my name, my Nigerian name, you don't know the meaning, just call me like that. Ismail, Rifa'i, Onirakumi, just call me Onirakumi, finish. So in the same way, this brother was a Somali brother. I don't know Somali, so everybody referred to him as Ali Gurwe. So I called him Ali Gurwe, meaning his surname is Gurwe. But I noticed the other Kenyans who spoke a different language, Swahili, they would refer to him Ali Fisi. So I'm thinking, is his name Gurwe or is it Fisi? Then I asked one day, what does Ali Gurwe mean? This brother had, subhanAllah, had very protruding front tooth, like buck tooth that came out like that. And Gurwe in Somali means hyena. And Fisi in Swahili also means hyena. So they call him Ali Hyena, like that. And this seemed acceptable to them. And he was used to it. Ali Gurwe, you answer, like this. So although culturally, it may seem acceptable, and this is not to say in that culture only, even where I come from sometimes, you know, there's ways that people refer to each other. In Nigerian, as Sheikh Suleiman will tell you, you know, if you have, for example, very big eyes, for example, which I was used to hearing all the time, Olojumoto, things like that, it's just like that. It's like normal, you know? I'm looking for Abdullah Bold, something like that, you know? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, do not call each other by alqab, by nicknames. Bi'sa ismul fusuq ba'da al-iman. Wretched is the name of disobedience after iman in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And importantly, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَنْ لَمْ يَتُبْ. Whoever doesn't repent from these actions, insulting, calling people by nicknames, فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْفَاسِقُونَ. These are the fasiqun. And a fasiq is a serious thing. It's not just the fact you be called a fasiq and it ends there. It's just a verbal, you know, punishment. Oh, he's a fasiq. It doesn't end there. It has consequences. The fasiq, the ulama say, لا يصح أن يكون وليا لابنته. The person who's a fasiq, it is not befitting for him to even marry his daughter off. He can't be a guardian for his daughter. And this is one of the things that makes a person a fasiq. Calling people nicknames, insulting people makes a fasiq. The fasiq, his testimony is never accepted in any court or during any case. A fasiq is not permissible for him to be an imam, to lead people in salah, ever. So the one who claims to have knowledge, yet it makes racist utterances and calls people bad nicknames, like Jews and Yusali bin Nas. The Fasiq, it's not permissible for him to even make the adhan. For him to even make the adhan. بِئْسَ الْإِسْمُ الْفُسُوقُ بَعْدَ الْإِيمَانِ وَمَنْ لَمْ يَتُوبُ. And whoever doesn't repent, so therefore it's upon them a repentance. فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْفَاسِقُونَ. They're for the fasiqun. They are the fasiqun. And what is a tawbah? التوبه الرجوع الى الله من معصيته الى طاعته. التوبه is to go back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from his disobedience to his obedience. And tawbah has shurut, conditions. So not every single person claims they repented have repented unless they follow these conditions. The first of these conditions is ikhlas, sincerity. You don't do it for the sake of your reputation, the sake of physical harm if you don't repent. No, you do it for the sake of who? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is a condition in every act of ibadah. So a person who works in the West, for example, America or England, as brothers tell you, racism, yes, discrimination is totally unacceptable. So a person who used to do those things and say, you know what, nowadays you can't get away with that, you know? You can't get away with calling people that are Pakistani the P words. You can't get away with using the N words. You know what, I can't do it. Is this sincerity? Not sincerity. You have to do it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That there has to be ikhlas. Secondly, at-tarq, to leave it off immediately. The second condition of tawbah, whatever sins you're doing, you have to leave it off immediately. And if it's an obligation you're not doing, you have to start doing that obligation immediately. The third condition of tawbah, the second condition was regret. You have to regret it, sincerely regret it. Yes, and the third condition mentioned is to leave it off. The fourth condition is azm. You have to have determination not to go back to that sin or that disobedience. And the fifth is to repent before the door of Tawbah is closed. Because the door of Tawbah closes. There's a general closing of the door of Tawbah. And the general closing of the door of Tawbah is that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala refers to. When he says, هَلْ يَنْظُرُونَ. Are they waiting except إِلَّا أَن تَأْتِيَهُمُ الْمَلَائِكَةِ. Are they waiting except that the angel comes to them? أَوْ يَأْتِيَ رَبُّكَ. Or your Lord comes to them. أَوْ يَأْتِيَ بَعْضُ آيَاتِ رَبِّكَ. Or some of the signs of your Lord comes to them. يوم يأتي بعض آيات ربك لا ينفع نفسا إيمانها إن لم تكن آمنت من قبل. The day some of the signs of your Lord comes, it will not benefit any soul to believe at that point. Like Fir'aun, when he reached that point, it will not benefit anybody when the signs of Allah comes if he's not believed before. And the tafsir explanation of the signs of your Lord, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, the general time the door of Tawbah closes when the sun rises from the west. At that point, no Tawbah. And the specific closing of door of Tawbah is when death, it comes to an individual. At that point, there's no Tawbah for a person. These are the conditions of Tawbah. However, some put a sixth condition, because this Tawbah is what's between you and Allah. What if you've taken from somebody else's rights? For example, a person stole money from somebody and he's repented to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Truly repented. He used to be a thief, for example. He stole. What about the person he stole from? Does he have to give that money back? They say, yes, he has to return that money. Because it's the haqq of, not Allah Azza wa Jalla, of another human being. And they say, haqqullah mabni ala musamaha. Allah's rights is built upon forgiveness. He forgives and pardons. Wa haqqul adami mabni ala mushahana. As for the son of Adam, dispute. He wants his right. He has to give that money back. If he's defrauded somebody, he has to pay the money back. If he cheated somebody, he has to pay it back. They say he has to pay it back. Now, what if a person fears, like in this specific case, you call somebody by a racist name, you use the nickname behind his back, what do you do? Like you stole money from somebody, you fear, if you go to him and say, Akhi, I stole this money, I used to be a thief, I defrauded you. You'll be arrested, you'll be put in prison, what should you do? They say, in that case, if it's a monetary issue, find somebody that is the person who you stole from, find somebody that he trusts a lot and he believes. And you get that person to go to him and say, look, such and such a person, he stole your money, he's asked me to return it. The reason he has to trust that person, imagine you lose like 100,000, for example. Somebody say, Akhi, somebody stole your money, I got all the money. The suspicion, if you don't trust that person, will fall on that person immediately. So it has to be somebody that person trusts. To go to him and say, look, I've recovered your money. The person repented to Allah Azza wa Jalla said to return your money. If you could not find such a person, they say, look, even if you have to deliver it mysteriously, type out a message, for example, your handwriting is not known, but you return the money, that suffices you to do it. What if he stole from many different people's a pickpocket? He stole from this bus, that train. What does he do? And he doesn't know we stole from, we took the money from, we defrauded. They said in that case, he gives it out. After trying all those other efforts, it doesn't work. Not you jump to this immediately. He gives it out as sadaqah, as a charity. Not for himself, but with the intention, the reward goes to the person he stole from. So here the ayah ends, and we move on to the saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اجْتَنِبُوا كَثِيرًا مِنَ الظَّنِّ إِنَّ بَعْدَ الظَّنِّ إِثْمٌ. That all you believe abstain from much suspicion. Verily, some suspicions are a sin. So even though Allah ta'ala says some are a sin, he told us to abstain from what? Many. Because to be extraordinarily careful. Inshallah ta'ala, next week, move on to this ayah. سُبْحَانَكَ اللَّهُمْ بِحَمْدِكَ أَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَٰهَ إِلَّا أَنْتَ أَسْتَغْفِرُكَ وَأَتُوبُ إِلَيْكَ.